Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick, your most favorite extreme radical brother from another mother. Praise the living God. Hallelujah. Brothers and sisters, I had a little bit of a vision the other day, or dream, a night vision, actually. As I was waking up, I had this vision. I've been dreaming about the end times, and then I don't remember what all it was, or it was complicated, but when I woke up, I saw this room. It was like a hotel room, and in that room was a whore. Prostitute, whore, like in the Bible, we're talking about like the whore of Babylon. And then beside her, she was on the bed. And then beside her, though, standing there, or sitting there, in the other side of the room was a leopard, brothers and sisters. Now, in the Bible, the leopard is one of the beasts that Daniel saw. And your scholars say that that leopard, of course, represents the Grecian people, or Greeks. Now, in the Bible, when we see in the New Testament the word Greek used, a lot of times it's talking about the Gentile people as a whole. All Gentiles. So the Gentiles is, the leopard is one of the representations of the Gentile kingdoms, brothers and sisters. So, but the Lord had led me to go do a little research here and talk about something that's connected to that. Of course, we're talking about the fact that those things symbolize the tribulation period. Now, what is the great, you know, the whore? Now we see in I want to say this because there's tons of people, as I always say, a disclaimer, there's tons of people that make videos who are not preachers, okay? And they say all kinds of stuff. So people ask me questions, well, somebody said this, that, and the other. People, there's all these wacky interpretations that people have, that, and that, you know, there's no basis in sound dividing of the word. But there's two different ones that we talk about, the whore of Babylon. There's Revelation 17 and Revelation 18. Now, one of them is talking about the harlot church, the one world church led by the false prophet from Revelation chapter 13. You see about the false prophet, the first beast, the Antichrist, the second beast, which is the false prophet. And the false prophet's job is to get everybody to take the mark of the beast, to worship the beast, to lead the one world religion. So a lot of times when I hear people say, as an example, you know, the Pope is a great candidate for the Antichrist, when in reality, if you read the Bible clearly, Revelation, the book of Revelation, not with an S on it, by the way, the book of Revelation. A lot of people talk in comments, talk about the book of Revelations with the S. I know right off the bat, they're not even paying enough attention to know not to add an S to it. How are they paying attention to all these deep biblical things? It's a good clue when someone is just running off at the mouth. You know, the Bible says to be slow to speak and quick to listen, but most people are quick to speak and slow to listen. And that's the ironic part of them making videos, is the fact that are they themselves even right with God? Are they themselves rapture ready? I mean, that's the big question. Anyway, brothers and sisters, so the false prophet is who more like the Pope would be, a false prophet, because he's leading people, or, you know, the head of Islam and all these other, whoever, like Joseph Smith they found in the Mormons, people like that who are leading people to a different gospel, or to even to a different religion, whatever it may be. Those would be your false prophets. Not when you read in the Bible, as I said, Revelation 13, at the beginning, you'll see that, and then in Daniel, we read about the Antichrist, like in Daniel chapter 9 and Daniel chapter 11, we see that the Antichrist is a political leader, a world leader. And then aka, you know, some people say, which is true, the word Antichrist is not in the book of Revelation. He's called the beast. In 1 John, we see the Antichrist. We see him back there as the man of the fierce countenance and all these things in Daniel, you know, the prince that will come. Daniel chapter 9 and chapter 11, we see him in those kind of terms, prince and king and all this kind of thing. A leader, you know, in charge of a nation, or ethos, a country, a group of people. Then, a Greek word is ethos. So then you have an ethnic group. And then you have the false prophet. So if someone talking about the Pope or whatever, or some religious imam, they're kind of more toward being the false prophet, the second beast, who's also called the false prophet in the book of Revelation. The first beast, Antichrist, political leader. Again, let me say this too, from Revelation chapter 13, I'm going to get into more of this teaching, but, you know, I got to cover these basics, because you always have to deal with people that's got all this misinformation from YouTube, and it's a shame, but, you know, that's what the Lord wants called me to do. So, that's why my videos end up being long. So, it says that the beast, the first beast, rises up out of the sea. Now, the Bible interprets itself. So if you read the Bible and study it, the sea represents the Sea of Nations. So it's telling us that the Antichrist will be from the Sea of Nations. And so the leper, as one of the animals in Daniel, used one of the beasts to describe, you know, they use these beasts, not a domesticated animal, but there's a different Greek word, just like we say in English, you know, an animal versus a beast. Not all animals are beasts, you know. So a beast is like a wild animal, like a leopard or a bear, you know, a lion, tiger, whatever. You're just domesticated animals like a cow, a chicken, whatever. So they're all beasts. And, you know, I made videos before. It's the way you see it where, you know, the, like, let's look at this this way. I want to get into all this other stuff. I don't know if I'll do it all in one video. But anyway, like, in Daniel, we see King Nebuchadnezzar, Daniel chapter 2. King Nebuchadnezzar has a dream of this statue, right? Of this statue. I even have a picture of it. That's, I'm not even getting into the message that I want. I'm getting into some teaching here. Where's that? I just had a picture of that statue. Wait a minute. Wait a second. I'm losing my place of what I want to teach. I've got this book of charts that I keep loaning out to people. It takes me forever to get it back. Daniel had a dream of a King Nebuchadnezzar had a dream of a statue, right? And so in Nebuchadnezzar's dream, it's always funny how you can't find something. I wasn't even intending on showing it to you guys. There it is. Okay, I got one. I got several different pictures of it. Here I got one picture. You can put it up there close. Now see, there's the statue on this side over here. You can see the statue. Now that is the dream that King Nebuchadnezzar had. And then look at on the other side, you see that later on in Revelation, or in Daniel, Daniel had dreams of these different beasts. There they are. You can stop it if you want to look at it more closely. And so Daniel had the beast. But think about it, brothers and sisters. Here's the point. God sees the kingdoms of this world as beasts. And here, King Nebuchadnezzar, as a, you know, an ungodly person, he sees the kingdoms of man in his dream as something awesome. You know, the head of gold, which is King of Babylon. And then Daniel seeing it as a righteous man, as God sees them as beasts. So that's why the Antichrist and all that will be great to the world. That's why the world, even though I do not believe that President Obama is the Antichrist, he's running out of time. And all those people saying he would be. He could become the Antichrist. He could become possessed by that spirit of Apollyon, the fallen angel, and become a Gibor, like Nimrod became a Gibor. Go look those things up. I've made videos about it. I can't do all things in the same video. But it's the same word used to describe the giants in Genesis chapter 6. They said they became, you know, men of old, men of renown, mighty men. And then Nimrod became a mighty hunter before the Lord. The same word is used there, Gibor. Giborim is the plural of Gibor. He became, so he had some change. So people take the mark, they will become a Gibor. They become a beast. In the eyes of God, they'll become a beast, a freak. That's why when you take the mark, you can't be saved. Because you will no longer be a human. When you take that mark, you'll have that DNA change. I go through this fast. And there's, you know, sometimes I get people, they can't follow it. They say, oh, it sounds like gibberish. Well, it's because, you know, you're a low-information person who tried to, you know, jump on the fast lane. You got to slow down. As I said, you got to be slow to listen and slow to speak and quick to listen, as the Bible says. So you have to go study these things. I'm throwing out all these big nuggets. And so if you don't know these things, you can email me at neartochrist@aol.com. You can ask me a question at the bottom. No problem with any of that. You know, then I, you know, every once in a while you get people that are just being belligerent. If you don't understand, it's so funny how people, I guess because they're not Christians, they deflect instead of saying, you know, they don't realize it when they say, oh, you're just talking. It's, they can't understand. So really you're saying, I'm ignorant. And, you know, you're announcing to everybody, you know, why? Just don't make a comment. Just privately email me and ask me or somebody else. You know, research it yourself using the Google. You don't realize that when you make a wacky comment, you're actually making yourself like you're dumb. You're ignorant. You know, and but what you know, instead of attacking me, I mean, all the things you're saying doesn't make sense. Well, we're always learning something. There's lots of things I don't know. Someone teach me, and if I wanted to learn about, you know, building an airplane, someone would have to teach me. I wouldn't go on a video about building airplanes and say, oh, you're just talking gibberish. Well, because I don't know the topic. I don't know why people always seem to think when it comes to the Lord, or, you know, and they're not even born again. They never read the Bible, and then but yet they're somehow born to be, you know, they correct preachers and stuff. It never ceases to amaze me, brothers and sisters. That's why what I wanted to talk about the message that I had, that I want to get into, was about the wheat and the tares and about the rapture. And I really get into it. The Lord has just confirmed to me again through this vision and what the Lord has shown me that the rapture is pre-tribulation. I made this video of who I think the Antichrist is. I said who I think. It's not a prophecy. I didn't have a dream or a vision or anything. All things I've studied, a guy who is a great candidate to be the Antichrist, whom I think could possibly be the Antichrist. That is the Prime Minister of Canada. He's a great candidate. I don't know that he is. He is a great candidate to be the Antichrist, just based on the things I've looked at. Even though there's many European leaders and stuff, royalty of the European families who are great candidates also. And brothers and sisters. Anyway, what I was going to say is that the video that I made, it's gotten like over 30,000 views in just a few days. It just took off. And it always amazes me and blows me away how many non-believers look at that stuff. And some of them are really insane and demonic and say, "Oh, I'm the Antichrist," or I'm the Messiah, or and all this belligerent stuff by the thousands. But yet, they're not saved. They don't know the Word of God. It's unbelievable, brothers and sisters. We are very close to the rapture of the church, the pre-tribulation rapture. In that video, I mentioned someone talked about Steve Quayle, and I said the thing about Steve Quayle is if you go back and listen to him, because I've listened to him for 16 years on a little here and there. I don't sit around listening to him, but he's been wide open, you know, hysterical that martial law is going to start tomorrow for the last 16 years, even though that will happen when the tribulation happens. All these things are going to go down with the tribulation, and then, you know, until you take the mark and all that for people who are left behind. But he does not believe in the pre-tribulation rapture, and neither does Alex Jones. And I've told you guys, the Lord gave me a word to pray for Alex Jones. He is doing a mighty work for God. He's been doing a mighty work for God. And even though, you know, God used King Nebuchadnezzar, wasn't him a Christian? Alex Jones is a God-fearer who's either barely saved or not saved, whatever. He's a God-fearer. He respects Christianity as a huge part of American history and something that needs to be maintained. Jesus said anyone that's not as with us is against us. You know. And so even one time there was someone that was casting out demons in the name of Jesus, healing people in the name of the Lord, and they said, "Oh, you want us to stop him?" And Jesus said, "No." You know, of course anybody that is with me is not against me, you know. And so we don't denounce people for not believing in the pre-tribulation rapture, but we, you know, as a preacher, I let people know, if you listen to people's teachings, that part of their teaching is wrong. And but we can, as I always say, for instance, I started on YouTube, the Moravians, go look that up if you don't know who they are. Their motto was, you know, in essentials, unity, and non-essentials, diversity, but in all things, love. Believing in the rapture is not an essential doctrine to be saved. You can still be born again and not believe in the rapture. You're just going to be wrong, but you can. And so people say stuff like, Steve Quayle believes in the rapture, but after the tribulation. So does Alex Jones. Well, after the rapture, after the tribulation, being raptured doesn't even make sense, number one, for many reasons. But number two, it wouldn't be much of a rapture if you already went through the tribulation. So to say someone is post-trib rapture is to say they don't believe in the rapture at all, because the Lord will descend and return to earth. And so if the rapture happened at the end of the tribulation, and be called up to meet the Lord in the air and then return with him directly to earth within seconds. So that wouldn't be no kind of rapture at all. You wouldn't be going to heaven, but you'd just be going translating and meeting the Lord and going to Jerusalem immediately. You know, so the reason why why I'm even talking about this, I guess the Lord's leading me to talk about it. The reason why the post-tribulation rapture is total nonsense is because several reasons. It's off the top of my head. Number one, the rapture, Jesus will come as a thief in the night. So if we know when the tribulation begins, when they make that covenant for 7 years, we have, and let me just say, there's lots of people who make comments, they don't even know what the Bible says. I'll give you the short version. The Bible tells us that the two witnesses will speak for a certain amount of days. Then the Antichrist, the first beast, who is the Antichrist? It's the spirit of Apollyon, Revelation chapter 9, I believe it's verse 11. You'll see, and then in Revelation chapter 11, when the two witnesses are killed, you will see that that's the beast that came, the captain over the bottomless pit, who is Apollyon, or Abaddon in the Hebrew, the destroyer. The son of perdition. Perdition is destruction, the destroyer. Apollonia in son of perdition there in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. From Apollyon, same word, same root word. So, the Antichrist, the first beast, Apollyon, in as walking around as a fallen angel appearing as a man, or a man possessed by that spirit, one of the two. He will go to the Temple Mount. He will kill the two witnesses mid-trib after they prophesy for 3.5 years, starting the day of the signing of the peace treaty. That's how you know. So when tribulation begins, at the making of a covenant to divide the land of Israel, to let them rebuild the temple and all that. They will have the Bible tells us there's a certain amount of days that they will offer sacrifices. It's like 18 months. So they have the rest of the first half of the tribulation to build the temple. They have like 18 months or whatever it is to build the temple. And then they have the rest of the time, which it gives the exact amount of days they will do sacrifices in the Bible. So they offer sacrifices for those certain amount of days. And the Antichrist can't touch them. They are protected. The two witnesses are protected. Mid-trib, they are not protected anymore. The Antichrist will kill them. They will fall dead. They will lay on the ground for 3.5 days. They will have a celebration at their death. The whole world will celebrate. The Lord will resurrect them and rapture them in front of the whole world. Every eye will see them be raptured after 3.5 days. But after they're killed, the Antichrist will go into the temple, declare himself to be God. That's mid-trib. Then the children of Israel, Revelation chapter 12, will flee into the wilderness to a place called Bozra. The Lord will return with bloodstains on his clothes from trotting the winepress of the Great Tribulation. The second half is called the Great Tribulation. The whole thing is called the Tribulation. The second half is called the Great Tribulation. The Lord will return to Bozra, which in modern day name is Petra, the Rose City there in the wilderness of Jordan. That is where the children of Israel will hide for the second half. And it tells how long. It's the second half of the tribulation. So there we see our 7 years. At the end of that time, when the Lord returns with 10,000 of his saints, we will return with the Lord in the air. In Jude, we see that. So quoting from the book of Enoch, seventh from Adam, that we will return. The Lord will return with 10,000. They didn't have the word millions and millions in those days. Tens of thousands of, you know, with 10,000 with a plural of his saints. That's the archaic language they used in the time of Enoch, seventh from Adam, way, way back, long before Moses and all that, before they came up with millions and billions and trillions and all that, that they had in the time of the Egyptians. In the archaic language, is tens of thousands. And so, that will be us. The Lord is going to prepare a place for us in his Father's house. In my Father's house are many mansions. John chapter 14, starting at verse 1. I go to prepare a place for you, that where I am you may be also. There with the Lord in those many mansions. The Lord will take us to himself. He will come as a thief in the night. That's a rapture. If we knew when the tribulation began and we were sitting around here as the tribulation started, we could calculate that 7 years. We could calculate those dates straight out of the Bible. So we could say, hey, we know the Lord will be here on Monday, the whatever it is, the 21st of September, 2000 and whatever, 7+ years from today. You sit there and calculate it. From the day the tribulation begins. The tribulation begins when they make that covenant to divide the land of Israel and let them rebuild the temple. Make peace in the world. Then after that, that's the date. Not the rapture, nothing else. That's the start, the kickoff. Daniel 9, 27. Read 26 and 27. Then after that, that's when things are happening. The witnesses should appear there at the Wailing Wall. They will appear in Jerusalem, literally, two men. Most people think it's Enoch and Elijah or Enoch and Moses. Elijah and Moses as appeared with the Lord on the Mount of Transfiguration, or Enoch and Elijah. They will be there at the Temple Mount. They will preach for that first half, like I said. You can see those things begin to happen. The mark of the beast will be introduced, all those things. And so at the end, if the rapture was at the end, we could calculate the date. So everyone would know the day of the hour if they calculated, if they read the Bible, became a tribulation saint. The church won't be here anymore. That's why we have the 144,000 Israeli males, 12,000 from the different tribes, will become the evangelists, the missionaries in the world, the apostles. Why? Because the church isn't here anymore. The church is not mentioned anymore after the end of Revelation chapter 2, chapter 3. The rest of it is about what's God's dealing with Israel. That's why it's called the time of Jacob's trouble. And so why am I doing this video talking about the proof of the rapture? The Lord is leading me to. The thing about people that don't believe in the pre-tribulation rapture, oh, they love to argue and debate and call people names. I don't see any pre-tribulation rapture people doing that. You know, thank God. That's another sign, you know, who's in the spirit of Christ by the way they react about it. And brothers and sisters, that's why I say people that don't believe in the rapture, they can still be born again. We need to pray for them, you know, that they will know the blessed hope. It says in there, and you know, when you say the blessed hope is the rapture, people say, oh, no, it's the appearing of the Lord. It says, you know, the blessed hope of the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord Jesus Christ, of course, that's not our hope. He's our salvation. He's more than our hope. He is our God, our salvation, our deliverer, our Messiah, all those things. Our blessed hope is his appearing, his glorious appearing, when we will go to be with him. Hallelujah. Titus 2:15 or 2:13? It's not in the top of my head right now. But anyway, brothers and sisters, since I'm doing this, I wanted to get into about this. The video's already getting long. You know, what can I do? I want to read these verse. I just want to say this verse to you. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 10. I don't know if I ever mentioned it in the video before. It says right here, Paul's talking. In 1 Thessalonians, where we see about the rapture, in one of the texts, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13 through 18, we see about the Lord descending from heaven with a shout, the voice of the archangel, and the trumpet of God. I quote that all the time. That in Christ shall rise first, and those of us who are alive and remain shall be caught up together to meet the Lord in the air. That whole, the whole books, both letters that we have that Paul wrote to Thessalonica, is about the end times. Verse 10, chapter 1, verse 10, 1 Thessalonians, and to wait for the Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, even Jesus, which delivered us from the wrath to come. Which delivered us from the wrath to come. And then in that same book, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 9, Paul says, because he has not appointed us unto wrath, but to obtain salvation to the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. There's lots of verses. Revelation 3:10, Jesus speaking to the church of Philadelphia. Just one out of seven, as I said, there are people that say they're saved or they're lukewarm or whatever. They're not all getting raptured. How do you get raptured? Not only being born again, salvation and going to heaven and the blessed hope of the rapture is two different things. A lot of times people, I don't know why they can't divide that in their mind or understand that being saved is means you're going to go to heaven when you die. But it doesn't say, oh, you got a rubber stamp. Oh, if the rapture happens in your lifetime, you're going to go too. There's a different thing here, the Lord says. Revelation 3:10, just to be raptured, not about salvation. If you're a born again Christian, Jesus said, Revelation 3:10, go read it. Jesus said, because you have patiently kept my word, or in the King James, kept the word of my patience, but the, you know, the modern English is, because you have patiently kept my word, I will keep you out of the hour of temptation that will come upon the whole earth to try all them that live on the earth. Talking about the tribulation. Luke 21:36, the Lord Jesus Christ talking about Luke 21, he's talking about the tribulation, the end times, his return and all that. When he gets done talking about the tribulation, he says, watch therefore and pray always that you be counted worthy to escape these things and stand before the Son of Man. Now, he did not say, for one thing, he said, pray always, not one prayer. He said, pray always that you be counted worthy to escape these things and stand before the Son of Man. Now, several times the Lord talks about being saved by believing on him. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whomsoever shall believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Several verses Jesus talks about, you know, believing on him, is salvation is through faith in Jesus Christ. But in this time, he doesn't say, well, if you believe on me, you'll escape these things. He said, pray, watch, therefore, and pray, you know, always, that you be counted worthy to escape these things and stand before the Son of Man. Revelation 3:10, to one of seven churches. He writes a letter to seven churches. One church, the Church of Philadelphia, he says, because, not because you believe on me, not because you're born again, he said, because you have patiently kept my word, I will keep you out of the hour of temptation that will come upon the whole earth. So that's a whole other thing, and I'm not going to get into that video. I made tons of videos about that. It's probably the biggest topic of videos I talked about, is setting yourself apart and being rapture ready. You got to be rapture ready, brothers and sisters. So let me talk in this video about the dream, about the harlot that I saw, and this is what the Lord gave me to look at this. As I've talked before, short version, Matthew chapter 13, the parable of the wheat and the tares. The church age, it says that, it says verse 24, Mark 13, 24, and I'll give you the other reference where the Lord gives the interpretation, starting in verse 37. This is Mark 13, both of these. You can go read these things. Jesus said, the kingdom of heaven is like a man that sows good seed in his field. But while the man slept, an enemy came and sowed tares among the wheat and went his way. Let me give you a clue. I've told you guys, if you want to know which translation of the Bible to use, go watch the video, the documentary by Chris Pinto, like pinto beans, called tares among wheat. And this is where he got this from. And then there's a second part to it. A Lamp in the Dark is the first one. Sorry. Lamp in the Dark, tares among wheat. It's a documentary about the history of the King James Bible and these other translations that they have, NIV and all that, and what you need to know about it. You'll find out the truth of these other translations and how they came about through the Jesuits. But it says, okay, when the man slept, his enemy came and sowed tares among the wheat and went his way. And when the blade was sprung up and brought forth fruit, there appeared the tares also. So the servants of the household came and said unto him, Sir, dost thou sow seed in thy field? From whence, where do these tares come from? Let me just say it in modern English. He said unto them, An enemy has done this. The servant said unto him, Wilt thou then go and gather them up? And he said, No, nay, let those, while you gather the tares, you'll also root up the wheat with them. Let both grow together until the harvest. In the time of the harvest, I will say to the reapers, Gather ye first the tares and bind them in bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat into the barn. Okay, then the Lord explains it. Verse 37. He said, The sower is the good seed. Of the good seed is the Son of Man. That's the Lord Jesus Christ. The field is the world. The good seed are the children of the kingdom, and the tares are the children of the wicked one. The enemy that sowed them is the devil, and the harvest is the end of the world, or the end of the age. The reapers are the angels. Therefore the tares are gathered and burned in the fire. It shall be in, as they are gathered and burned in the fire, so shall be at the end of this age. The Son of Man shall send forth his angels, and they shall gather out of his kingdom things that offend, and them that shall do iniquity, and shall cast them into the furnace of fire. Therefore shall be wailing and gnashing of teeth. Then shall the righteous shine forth as the sun in the kingdom of their Father. He who has an ear, let him hear. All right, brothers and sisters, check it out. The field is the world. Now, the Lord, at the end of the tribulation, the Lord returns to the earth, to the field, with his people. He returns to the field. Then we shine like the sun and all that stuff. But he says in the parable that is read that the wheat is gathered into the barn. See, he doesn't give us interpretation what the barn is. It's heaven. The field is the world, the earth. So the Lord gathers the wheat into his barn. As a matter of fact, there's a prophecy back in Isaiah. You have to Google it because I can't think of it off the top of my head. And it says that, let them come and hide until the indignation of the Lord shall pass. You know, let them hide. So the Lord will hide us. We'll be the hidden bride. We'll be hidden in Christ. We'll be there in heaven with the Lord. We'll be in the barn while the Lord is destroying these tares, abundantly and cast them into the fire. Then we will return, brothers and sisters, we will return with the Lord as he spoke through Enoch, the seventh from Adam, quoted by Jude, the half-brother of Jesus Christ, that we shall return with the Lord at the end of the tribulation. There's tons of verses. You can Google that. Google this. Bible verses of the second coming of the Lord, the return to earth, verses, Bible verses for the rapture or harpozo. Go look those up and see the different Bible verses. I've named some to you. The rapture, the Lord will meet us in the air. He will come as a thief in the night. We will go there into the barn. We'll be gathered into my Father's house or many mansions. We will go there to there. We'll be there with him. The second coming, every eye shall see him. The whole world will mourn because of him. You know, he'll return to earth. He'll step down to earth. He'll land on the Mount of Olives. Zechariah chapter 14, it'll split in two and he'll walk in there. Zechariah chapter 12, the nation of Israel will mourn for the one they pierced. All those things. Everyone will see him. He'll return. He'll destroy the Antichrist and his people with the brightness of his appearing, you know, in the word of his mouth, the sword of the Spirit coming out of his mouth. He'll say, be destroyed, or whatever he says to them. The sword of the Spirit, the word, when he speaks, that's just like a new Bible verse being written. When Jesus speaks, it's like a new Bible verse because he is the word of God. He is the word. Everything he says, that's why it says, out of his mouth in Revelation comes a sword. That's the word. When he speaks, that's the word. Hallelujah. He is the word. That's why he said, let there be light. Jesus is the one. The Father plans, the Holy Spirit executes, and the Son speaks. It's a theology of how it works with God. Hallelujah. Praise God. With the one God. Hallelujah. Praise his name. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I wanted to get in that and say this. Also, just to connect this, the harlot church, as we know, the Pope is right in the middle of that. So when I see the Pope and the harlot, as I said in the beginning of this, Revelation 17, there's and 17 and 18, there is economic whore of Babylon, which is the businesses of the world. And then there's the ecumenical religious whore of Babylon, which I believe definitely is the Catholic Church as a representation of that, brothers and sisters. And all other denominations that have been falling away so fast, it ain't even funny, that are even more falling away than the Catholics. I see these old mainline Protestant denominations with a lesbian bishop or a gay man bishop who's left his family and living with another dude and living in sodomy. And he's the head of this denomination. You know, it was like Presbyterian USA, whatever it was. And they're denying the virgin birth. They deny the inerrancy of the Bible and all these things. Whereas the Catholic Church, they overdo the idea of the virgin birth. I mean, they're worshiping, many of them are worshiping Mary. They say they're not worshiping, they're just admiring and adoring, and they even, you know, they even have admiration of the wafer. I mean, they worship a piece of bread as the literal flesh of Christ and all those things. I don't even want to get into that. Transubstantiation, you can look that up, where they believe when they eat the communion and the wine, it literally becomes flesh and blood. They call it taking vitamin J, that they receive grace by that ceremony, the sacraments of the Catholic Church. I don't want to get into all those doctrinal things. I've studied it a lot and dealt with that a lot in apologetics and ministering to people from different religions as part of being a pastor. But the main point is if you think about this, a harlot, just like Hosea in the Old Testament, he has an unfaithful wife. So, you know, it's not like, you know, I mean, the thing about the harlot is like unfaithful. So when you talk about Islam and things like that, even though they're cults and false religions and all this, they're not being unfaithful because they never were. You know what I'm saying? They never were part of God. So when you talk about, you know, being unfaithful, you're talking about a religion that has fallen away. It was like Israel fell away from God. You see these patterns. God has everything laid out in patterns. Whether it be good or bad, it's all in patterns. Like 666 is the number of man. 777 is the number of God. Completion, the number 3 is the Trinity. 2 is the witness. You know, 1 is God. And all the, whatever. You look at all those different things. Those numbers, colors, etc. God uses black, you know, whatever, like a, you know, the demons or whatever and all this kind of stuff. Light is God, you know, and holiness and truth of God, light, you know, like pure light, like Shekinah glory of God, you know, whatever. Red is war, as example, on the negative side. And on the positive side, the blood of Christ, whatever. All those things. And so God lays out in patterns. So imagine this. And I heard an old preacher that I know when I was a kid, where I got saved, the church I got saved at, an old Baptist church, Mission Baptist Church, the pastor said this. He said, talking about the rapture, he said that, can you imagine if you were engaged to somebody and then you went to the house to pick them up and marry them, the woman, you go to the woman, the girl's house to pick her up to marry her, and then you look through the window and there she's in the bed with another man. Now, are you still going to get her and marry her? You know, and that's one of the you know, the one-liners you can use to talk about, you know, you have to be kind of worthy to escape these things. That's what we're talking about. Baptist church, once saved, always saved church. But the pastor was talking about that, you know, the faithfulness. As you talk about the apostate harlot church that's compromised with the world, like Roman Catholicism and all of your mainline denominations, what you call mainline Presbyterians and Lutherans and all those Methodists, etc., that's totally compromised with the world, denying the Word of God, denying the virgin birth, denying the deity of Christ, etc., 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 embracing the homosexual agenda, but even bigger than that, denying that Christ is God. So, I mean, that's the killer right there. These other things are bad, but the killer is denying who's Christ. You know, and salvation is in Christ alone, and you know, John 14:6, Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and life. No one comes to the Father except by me. They start denying that. I mean, that is definitely, hey, you're outside the bounds of Christianity. These other things, of course, they're abominations and they're wicked, but where's the point where you're, hey, you're a bridge too far? Denying who's Christ and salvation through Christ. Denying the one that has begotten thee, the one that saved us, the Lord Jesus Christ. And so it all starts with denying the inerrancy of the Word of God. Denying the infallibility of the Word of God. That's where it always starts. That's the problem with these other Bible, these new translations of the Bible. They come from an erroneous text that was planted by the Catholic Church. Go see those videos, those documentaries, A Tare Among Wheat, Tares Among Wheat and A Lamp in the Dark, I think is part one. Anyway, by Chris Pinto. So what else was I going to... So, brothers and sisters, as I said, for the individual, it's the same thing. Are you part of the harlot church, the unfaithful bride, who's not going to be taken? You know, that's why another thing about it, the whole thing, Jesus talks in John 14, and he talks about in my Father's house are many mansions, and I'm going on, praise God for those of you who love to be discipled by a pastor. The Lord said, in my Father's house are many mansions, I go to prepare a place for you. If it were not so, I would have told you. You know, I go to prepare a place, and then I'll receive you unto myself. Now, in that text, you know, let your heart not be troubled, neither be afraid. It's the beginning of that text. That's after he had rebuked Peter and said, you know, you'll deny me three times and all that. He went into that text. And so, in the old days, if you haven't heard this, in the Jewish weddings, the son, the guy would go be betrothed, like Joseph was betrothed to Mary, which is like extreme engagement. Okay, it's more than engagement, but less than marriage. You get betrothed to someone, and then you haven't married them yet. It's not a sealed deal. Hey, that's a whole nother video about once saved, always saved. I never even thought about that. You're betrothed, but you know, when Jesus found out that, when Joseph found out that Mary was pregnant, he was going to put her away privily, as the King James word. He was going to put her away, take her to another town, and put her away with her relatives, like in another place, like when she went to visit Elizabeth. Put her away and not marry her. You know, just put her away somewhere. But instead, he had the dream that, hey, this child is from the Most High, so he married, took Mary as his wife in this case. But if she had been unfaithful, he would not have taken her. That's, I never even thought about that. Praise God. See, the Holy Spirit is so awesome. Never even thought about it. There's a type right there of among types. There's lots of types. That's one I never even thought about. So you can use that when you talk to people about being rapture ready. Individually, let's talk about individual, because we can't change what the Catholic Church is doing and all that. A lot of people, that's why I'm tripping on these people on the internet, because they're all obsessed about these things. What about yourself, man? Get yourself right. You know, get the big stick out of your eye before you worry about the splinter that's in somebody else's eye. You know, unless God called you to be a preacher. 99% of them are not preachers, so I don't know what they're doing. But you need to get yourself right. We all need to get ourselves right first. Physician, heal thyself. And so, once you, okay, so that's how you can share with people. These are the one-liners I wanted to share. I made a video one time called Jesus is not a wife beater. That's one you can use to simply tell someone in 30 seconds that there's a pre-tribulation rapture. Jesus is not going to go to his in-law's house, his future in-law's house, go to his betrothed bride, beat her up for 7 years, and then say, okay, let's go to our, into the wedding chamber, sweetheart. It's not going to happen. It's crazy, crazy, crazy. That's why I told the video, Jesus Christ is not a wife beater. You know, and I told Brother Sid at that time, I was down in South Carolina, I was talking to Brother Sid, you know, I said, you know, I wish I could get a picture of Jesus wearing one of those wife beater shirts, you know, a union. It's actually called a union shirt or something. They used to call it some kind of wife beater shirt and have a picture of Jesus on there with a wife beater shirt, you know. I mean, it's just ridiculous and it's just insane. So that's the quickest way. You know, you got to use these one-liners as the Lord, I think the Lord for all those nuggets he gave me. So as an example, like I said, there is a pre-tribulation rapture because Jesus is not a wife beater. You can tell people that. You got to be rapture ready because Jesus isn't going to show up at his in-law's house, see his bride in the bed with another man, another religion, living in sin, etc., playing the harlot. He's not going to marry that harlot. The faithful bride. The faithful bride. The faithful bride. Jesus is coming for a faithful bride. Those who have not denied my name. That's what Jesus told them to the church of Philadelphia. You have not denied my name. You know, when I first started studying this, the Baptists would always say they were the church of Philadelphia. You know, and they have these timelines of those different churches in Revelation chapter 2 and 3. You know, the Baptists have been huge, like Schofield turned out to be right. You know, Schofield, who was a Baptist, was the only one saying that Israel was going to return as a nation, literally. One of the only people in America was saying that. Everybody else was laughing him to scorn. But he wrote his, you know, wrote his, he's got a Bible with a commentary on there, the Schofield Bible. It's what most Baptist preacher uses. And then that's why the Baptists have had a great tradition in the last 100 years of helping develop the understanding of the end times. Now, I want to say this. You could go back to the, because I deal with all these whack jobs. People talking about the word rapture and talking about the rapture was only introduced in the 1830s. That's not true. I have people ask me that all the time. And I tell them, stop being so lazy. Stop babbling and copying and pasting what you saw on the internet. A simple Google search of a history of the rapture doctrine will show you where Irenaeus, who was a disciple of Polycarp, who was a disciple of John, who wrote the book of Revelation there from Ephesus after he was at Patmos, He wrote it and then he went back to Ephesus, okay, and delivered it to the church from after he got out released from Patmos, the Isle of Patmos. So only once removed from John, he wrote in Against Heresies, Book 4, about the rapture. And only, no, no, there's tons of people in the early church who wrote about a pre-tribulation rapture. It was taught by many of the church fathers, the early church fathers, way back in the beginning, before there was a Roman Catholic Church and all those things. And so what happened is we went through the Dark Ages caused by the Whore of Babylon, the religious Whore of Babylon. That's why they call it the Dark Ages. They tried to destroy the Bible. Do you know that before the beginning of the Roman Catholic Church, there were thousands and thousands of different copies of the Bible in thousands and thousands and thousands of different languages, or whatever, hundreds of different languages, whatever there were. And then they tried to destroy every copy of the Bible and just have it there in Latin. They had some original Greek, Hebrew stuff, but they tried to destroy it in all these other languages. But it just so happens that people hid some copies. And so there were copies of the Bible hidden during all the Dark Ages. And then, of course, you had Martin Luther, and then you had there, Wycliffe and all them, and what happened, and you know, in England, you know, how ironic it was that King Henry wanted to get a divorce, but out of that, through his illegitimate daughter Elizabeth the First, you know, and then down to the gay guy King James, who commissioned the King James Bible. You hear people say, "Oh, King James was gay." They say he was gay, but he didn't write any Bible. He just commissioned to have it done. He paid for it to be written, you know, put together. But he wasn't involved in any translation, anything like that. He just commissioned. God used him. King Henry was a big womanizer, but God used him to bring about the Reformation, break that power of the Babylonian harlot church, to bring forth what we have today. The restoration of the church through Martin Luther and those other guys brought us where we are today, brothers and sisters, to the restoration of the remnant of the church, just as the church began on the day of Pentecost. Let me give a word as from the Lord that I've said before, as the Lord has shown me. The church began with the sound of a mighty rushing wind and fire from heaven, and was born unpredicted, caught the apostles off guard, caught Israel off guard. It was hidden in the Old Testament. The church was, boom, it was born on the day of Pentecost. Everybody didn't know, nobody knew what was happening. Even the apostles were like, didn't know this was going to happen. They knew that the Lord was going to tarry in Jerusalem to receive the Holy Spirit. You receive power from on high. They didn't understand what was happening. Boom, everyone was blown away by it. The disappearance of the church would be the same way. The church started with 120 people, then it went out bigger and bigger and bigger. Then it got started having watered down, watered down, watered down, watered down. Then the Lord is just reversing that back at like 1500 and all that. The church has been being restored back to a small group of like the original faithful people. Think about this, brothers and sisters. I know this video is long, but praise God for those who love the Word of God and preach it. Over 500 people saw the risen Christ at one time. So we don't know how many people actually saw the Lord after he was risen. But Paul said that at one day, at least 500 people saw him. So total is at least 500 or 700, 800, whatever. But on the day of Pentecost, there was only 120 of that group that were faithful enough to tarry at Jerusalem, to fast and pray, to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. So is the same in the end, brothers and sisters. Those who receive the truth and grow in the maximum amount of God restoration of the church all the way to that day. That's your bride right there, brothers and sisters. The hidden, faithful bride. And now in every denomination, even I will say even in the Catholic Church, God has his people everywhere. Every one of those denominations that I mentioned that have fallen away and part of the harlot, there's God's got his people there. There's tares among wheat. You talk about, you know, I mentioned about the Baptists. I said something good about the Baptists. Assemblies of God. Church of God, the most Pentecostal, Spirit-filled churches you could go to, raising dead people. There are people in that church that are on their way to hell. There are tares right in there. I don't care that some of them are preachers, whatever. There's tares everywhere, brothers and sisters, and there's wheat everywhere in all these churches. That's why, you know, we don't just abandon those places. The Lord leaves his witnesses there, brothers and sisters. Believe it or not, God has witnesses in all these places. Hallelujah. Those people will have that played back to them when they get to heaven. There was one member of that congregation that came and talked to him. Somebody came to a Catholic priest and said, "Father, it says, and Jesus said in the Gospel of Matthew, don't call any man father, because you have one father that's in heaven. So why is it that you want to be called father? Why is it in Hebrews where it says, you know, those priests keep standing in the temple offering sacrifices every day when Jesus offered himself once and for all? So why is it you have a perpetual sacrifice of the Mass when Jesus is already there? He's already finished it. He's not on that crucifix anymore. He's not there. He's risen. Hallelujah. He's not in perpetual sacrifice. It was finished. It's over with, as Jesus said. So someone's going to say that to a Catholic priest. And then that priest will have to give an account for that when he didn't teach that, when he didn't respond to that gospel of Jesus Christ and get born again and start preaching that like Martin Luther, Catholic priest, got saved. The just shall live by faith. And began to preach the truth in the Catholic Church. They ended up, you know, throwing him out. They tried to kill him, etc. He, you know, wrote a letter, the 95 Theses, and put it on the door of the Wittenberg Church there on All Saints Day. You know, the Catholics have All Saints Day, November the 1st, actually November the 1st, Reformation Day. Hallelujah. When, you know, that light went out from there, a thunderous sound of the restoration of the church done by the Spirit of God. Hallelujah. Step by step, even today, still finishing the final restoration of the hidden bride, the faithful bride. Brothers and sisters, and that's what I want to tell you. We're out of here soon. The day is coming, even now, even at hand, when the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trump of God. Hallelujah. If you're having trouble getting through, you know, read the third psalm. Read the, we've talked about the 91st psalm is awesome. The 23rd psalm, the Lord is my shepherd. The 91st psalm, you know, he who dwells in the secret place of the Most High God shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say to the Lord, he is my shield and my, you know, he is my strength. You know, in him shall I trust. I'm mixing up Psalm 3 because that's what I want to talk about. Psalm 3, hallelujah. Thou, O Lord, are a shield to me. Hallelujah. 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 Praise God. The glory and the lifter of my head. Hallelujah. For thou, O Lord, are a shield for me. The glory and the lifter of my head. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I shall not be afraid of 10,000s of demons that encamp themselves against me all around, because thou, O Lord, art a shield to me, the glory and the lifter of my head. Hallelujah. Bless his name. What did God tell Abraham? When Abraham's like, well, what's my reward? God said, I am your reward. I am your shield and your buckler. Hallelujah. I'm your ever-present help indeed. Hallelujah. That's why Abraham called him El Shaddai, God Almighty. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God, brothers and sisters, to whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all ye creatures here below. Praise God, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Brothers and sisters, I will be being in the States in April, brothers and sisters, in April. I will start spending the majority of my time in the USA, brothers and sisters, starting this year, as the Lord showed me when I came here in 2007. After 9 years and 9 months, I would begin focusing on the ministry to the American and the Western church. And so that 9 years and 9 months will be up at the end of March. Praise God, as the Lord has brought everything together. Still be doing the ministry here. Still be doing it through the house parents. Still be doing it online. And I'll still be coming here by the grace of God every year for a few months. Every year, people might want to come with me as short-term mission work. You know, I'll come here and make any adjustments that need to be done, brothers and sisters. Anyway, I love you. I praise God for anyone that watches this video. You know, when you go to church, it lasts for an hour or 2 hours. But anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you. I want to pray for you. Father, in the name of Jesus, I ask you to bless your people, Lord God. Fill your people with thy spirit, Lord God. Hallelujah. 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 I just hear the Lord saying, he who now lets will let. Hallelujah. That's from 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Talking about the Holy Spirit, the restrainer. Hallelujah. Until the Holy Spirit is removed, the church, through the church, then the son of perdition will be revealed. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. You read that whole chapter, you'll see that the restrainer, some people try to say it's the Archangel Michael. The Archangel Michael can't restrain evil. The force of evil is only restrained by the force power of the Holy Spirit. Through the church, us, brothers and sisters of salt and light, the true bride, we're going to be out of here, brothers and sisters. Hallelujah. The Lord's going to take us home. May the Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face to shine upon you. Lift up his countenance on you and give you his peace. I speak that blessing from Numbers chapter 6 upon you right now in the name of the only begotten of the Father, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Messiah. May his charistos, his charisma, his anointing rest upon you in the name of himself, the Lord Jesus Christ. God bless you all.